So today I'm going to be presenting new work, and this is very much proof of principle, initial days, and getting started, and trying to consider how is it that working memory fits with the concept of predictive coding. As far as I know, I haven't seen any formal or informal treatment of that, except for perhaps Carl's presentation actually just at this workshop, which is not yet published. So there's still going to be a lot of details to understand and work through. And so I really would love it if you all could comment and offer some feedback and so forth, and we can do this very interactively here. I'm going to start out a bit by giving you a general introduction onto predictive coding. It's going to be pretty quick. And then a small introduction on working memory dynamics and what we currently think, what's the dominant model, before then getting into recordings that I've done at MIT in frontal circuits using laminar probes, and then wrap it all up and see if we can make some progress on this. So predictive coding offers a computational role for feed-forward and feedback connections. So what I've drawn here is that we expect hidden causes and hidden states in the external environment here on the left to interact together to produce a particular set of sensory causes, which then enters into our brain. So our brain is here on the right, the environment is here on the left, and what this sort of shows is that for each hidden cause of our sensory data, we probably have a different hierarchical level, or this is the predictive coding model, we have a different hierarchical level for unpacking those hidden causes and hidden states, right? And so we do this by an interaction between prediction error units, which feed forward, and state units or prediction units, which feed back in a highly recurrent and hierarchical way, right? So yesterday we were talking a little bit about how, well, it's still unclear what really predictive coding says. This is really one of the core tenets here, so I just want to be clear about that. So in 2012, the paper that Lars mentioned, I, together with Carl and others, we proposed a canonical microcircuit model for predictive coding. So basically taking those computations that we think are going on, this message passing between prediction errors and predictions, and mapping them on to a cortical circuit, a laminar cortical circuit with particular cell types and particular layers. So layer 2, 3, the superficial layers, layer 4, layer 5, 6. And so the idea is that activity sense data would enter in at layer 4, get processed by recurrent connections, and either feed forward from the superficial layers or feed back to the next earlier cortical area through the projections from the deep layers. In addition to that, an important computation, we think, happens in the superficial layers, which is the computation of the prediction error unit itself, which is nothing more than a subtraction between the high-level prediction coming from the previous area, right? From the next higher area of the cortex, with the current states or the current sensory data which we actually get. And so this subtraction of the current sense data from the prediction generates the prediction error unit, which is then weighed by the precision. And then this weighted prediction error gets sent up the hierarchy. So that's the basic model, right? In addition to that, what we also predicted on theoretical grounds is that there would be differences in the spectral content between the units encoding prediction error and the units encoding states. Namely, that there should be a selective loss in the higher frequencies in moving from prediction error units to predictions. And so deep prediction units, we thought, would use beta instead of gamma, or preferentially use lower frequencies, whereas feed-forward prediction error units were predicted to signal those events preferentially using faster frequencies, for example, gamma. So again, the gamma superficial encoding prediction error we proposed would feed forward, and the prediction units generating hypotheses that would then be tested against states at earlier levels we predicted to be in the deep units feeding back. And so I guess now in this conference here, we've seen already some evidence in support of this model, some evidence a little bit contradictory to the model. For example, Elias's work showing that the prediction error units might be in the deep layers. But we also saw that from Lucia Maloney's talk that this model, that there is some evidence for this model, namely gamma feed forward associated with prediction errors. So while this is not an established model, it does give us an initial blueprint for thinking about how is it that canonical cortical computations could give rise to prediction error in the brain. So my work that I did with Pascal Fries and Julien Velozzi and colleagues confirmed this idea that when you look at cortical-cortical connections in the bottom-up direction versus the top-down direction, that the predicted directionality in terms of frequencies comes out. Namely, that in the bottom-up direction, we have gamma band influences predominating. And in the top-down direction, i.e. descending the hierarchy, we have the beta band, alpha-beta band interactions dominating. And this was done strictly based on anatomy. So we took different areas of the cortical hierarchy in the macaque based on their visual position, i.e. Fellman and Vanessen, or other models of anatomical hierarchy. And then we simply assessed functional connectivity, directed functional connectivity in this case, with Granger causality between the areas, and separated whether the direction should be ascending or descending the hierarchy. And we found this spectral dissociation. So again, gamma feeding forward, beta feeding back. And so together, putting these two insights together, the sort of idea that emerges is that hierarchical message passing between areas using the scheme might actually implement predictive coding and result in things like optimal perception. So we have, again, this canonical microcircuit model at each stage of the hierarchy. We have the prediction errors flowing forward, and we have the predictions flowing back. And also in sort of newer formulations, we have also these descending modulatory effects, which can implement things like attention. And then on top of that, we expect that feed-forward information flow might use gamma and feedback in alpha or beta. OK, so that was the quick summary of sort of what is the current model that we think in terms of the underlying circuits that are behind predictive coding. Now, to turn to the question of the talk, how is working memory conceptualized within predictive coding theory? And here we have much less things to go on. I sort of had a little bit of a hidden agenda when I asked our philosopher friend here about how is imagination encoded in this scheme. And the idea is that maybe we have, in addition to just sense hierarchies, we have higher order hierarchies. But this sense, this notion is relatively unestablished, as is in predictive coding theory. So I would say the game is still open here. I see potentially two possibilities here, just taking the different knobs that we already have within the predictive coding framework and trying to turn those knobs and see if they'll give us working memory type responses. And again, by working memory, what do I mean? I just mean holding things in mind which are not present in the external world, or maybe which are present, but you're not representing sensory information. You're representing thoughts. You're representing things that will, in a cognitive sense, that aren't directly tied to sense data, right? And so typically predictive coding is thought to inhibit sensory percepts in order to have optimal perception. But so here, what might be happening for working memory? So the two possibilities I see is that you might have an increase in deep cell activity. Remember, those were the state units that are sending predictions down the hierarchy. And so maybe what working memory is that you create a prediction, which maybe isn't satisfying an immediate sense percept, but maybe will serve to predict a future sense percept, correct? And that the difference indeed is that there are different timescales in which this whole scheme has to happen. The other possibility is that you might get superficial layer cell activity, which is more tied to prediction error. And there the interpretation might be that you're signaling an error at the higher levels of the hierarchy, because what you predict i.e. what you have in your mind is not present in the actual environment, right? So these are the two possibilities. Now, before we test that, I just want to say a quick word about what are the current models of how working memory works in frontal cortex. So we've had this dominant model now for many years, decades, about 30 years, since we initially identified delay period activity, sustained firing rates in prefrontal cortex to items that were not currently present, right? So the idea has been for a long time that that sustained activity is what is implementing working memory. Now, the emerging model is that sparsely active neuronal ensembles code working memory by taking turns in being active, right? And so each active state is accompanied by a burst of gamma band oscillations and spikes, which are informationally rich and encode working memory, but that you don't have any single unit that is sustaining its firing rate throughout the entire time, right? And so this emerging model recently had some evidence from the lab where I'm at, Earl Miller Lab, so my colleague Michael Lundqvist published some work showing exactly this, that you have certain units that are in sites that have bursts of gamma band activity, and other units which have spikes. They're in prefrontal cortex, they have spikes, they're doing something, but they don't have gamma band oscillations. And what he found is that the sites that don't have any gamma band oscillations but still have spikes don't actually convey information about what is being held in working memory. Whereas sites that do have gamma band oscillations and obviously have spikes, their spikes are informative about the contents of working memory and can be used as a readout, if you will, of the whatever item that the animal was keeping in working memory. In this case, it's typically a delayed match to sample kind of paradigm. And the other important thing is that these gamma bursts, they were punctate in time. So they weren't the typical more sustained gamma band oscillations that we think of when we think of bottom-up stimulation through the hierarchy. Instead, they were punctate in both space and time. And they could co-occur at a wide range of frequencies. And the burst rate would increase during the delay, during the memory maintenance delay. In gamma, selectively, in beta, they would drop. And so the information-rich dynamics were really happening in gamma. And so now this is the setup to my talk. So how do we what do we see if we actually analyze data from laminar circuits? And which of these dynamics is going to come out in which layers? And is that more evidence for a sort of prediction error type signal or a state type signal? So to get into that, I performed some recordings with Roman Lunas, a PhD student in the lab. And we targeted two high-level frontal areas, PMd and SEF. These are areas that are involved in saccade planning. And they are high up in the hierarchy, and they have a disgranular cortical anatomy. That is to say, they lack a very clear layer 4. They have only a distinction between mostly superficial layer 2, 3, and deeper cells in layer 5, 6. This is white matter. And this is histology that you can just download in macaque. So this isn't from the actual animal that we recorded from. But I just want to point out that there's this nice resource in case you want to look at anatomical maps. So the recordings that we did were laminar recordings. We performed 18 penetrations using multi-laminar linear probes called V probes. The inner electrode spacing was 200 or 150 micrometers, and each contact had 16. Each electrode had 16 contacts, and the probes were positioned. Now, this is a very important thing that came up in Lucia's talk. How do you position the probes to ensure whether you're recording superficial or deep activity? This was done in numerous different ways, including current source analysis to try to identify what is the middle of the column in terms of the current sources and sinks. And we also looked at, I'm not going to talk about this today just for time, but we also used the power profile because it changes quite dramatically when you go above the pia or into the white matter. And then, you know, electrode depths, which we could measure, and the presence or absence of spikes. So together, we're pretty confident that we can at least do a somewhat gross simplification laminar position. So the first thing we observed is that when we recorded just sort of passive viewing data in this animal, is that there were changes in the spectra that seemed to be highly related to the cortical depth. So here what I'm plotting is whether the electrode was in the superficial most contact or the deep most contact, 1 through 16. And here is the normalized power in the gamma band or the alpha band, normalized to the contact with the highest power. So what you can see here is that at the alpha and particularly the broadband gamma range, you have quite some variability in terms of power over the different 16 sites. And we can see here that that variability in power is quite closely linked to whether you're superficial or deep. And so as previously reported in visual cortex, what we see also now in prefrontal cortex is that gamma band power tends to peak in the more superficial layers and then decreases in the deep layers, whereas the alpha power has the opposite profile. It tends to peak in the deep layers. And this crossover point is also very highly interesting because that seems to correspond to around the contact sites where we see the current source density sinks, so where the initial sensory inputs are coming into the column. Seems to map on to the crossover point. This observation is highly reproducible across multiple penetrations that we did in these areas. So now to get into the task that we used in order to tap into working memory representation, we used a masked delayed saccade task. So the animal fixates in the middle for 500 milliseconds, obtains a cue indicating which location to hold in working memory. Then that cued location, instead of disappearing, is joined by all possible other locations. So it's masked by all possible locations. And then after a variable delay of between 1.7 to 2.7 seconds, the mask disappears and the center changes color. The fixation dot changes color, indicating that it's now time for the animal to respond. And then the animal has to make a saccade to the remembered location. And if he makes a saccade there, he gets a juice reward. And if not, then he doesn't get a reward. So this is how we are operationalizing working memory here. So the initial thing that we observed is that when we look at the time frequency representation of the spectra in the superficial versus deep channels, by and large, they look sort of similar, although they're doing slightly distinct things. And I'll just point you a few things to notice. So at time zero is the presentation of the cue. So you have a somewhat faint but present initial sensory response in the gamma band range. Then at the presentation of the mask, you have a much stronger response, which is then sustained throughout the delay period. And again, this sustained response is not happening on each individual trial. It's more or less an artifact of averaging across many, many trials. So then you start to blur when these gamma bursts are actually happening, right? And the gamma band power in general seems to also increase towards the end of the delay, i.e. towards the end of the time period in which the animal needs to actually use the item held in working memory and execute a saccade. In parallel with that, we also see quite a strong decrease in the beta band and an increase in the theta slash alpha range, selective to the delay period. I'm not going to really emphasize the differences between superficial and deep now. I'll get to that in a second. And again, I should have mentioned this, but superficial versus deep was taken to mean the contacts above that current source density location, which was generally in the middle of our contact spacing, and generally also at the point of intersection between gamma and alpha profiles. So that's how we separated superficial and deep. Again, this is just an initial look. In the future, we also plan to look at a more granular type analysis that doesn't just make a simple dissociation. But this is an initial starting point to looking at this question. So the next thing I wanted to look at was the gamma band bursts, right? So we know from my colleague's work, that these bursts are really important in representing information in working memory. So I wanted to look for them also in these data. So the way that I did the analysis was that I measured the gamma band power time course over the course of the experiment. And then a burst was defined as a particular time period in which the power exceeds 2 times the standard deviation and does so for at least 3 oscillation cycles. So the gamma bursts were detected in this range here of 30 to 120 hertz. I also looked for beta bursts happening in 12 to 30 hertz. So just to give you a visual depiction of what these look like, on any particular trial, you might get a burst that looks like this or like that. It's highly stochastic in their nature. They, in general, are pretty punctate in both space and time, but they do have to exist for at least 3 oscillation cycles. And the statistics of the bursts were that over electrodes, about 2 to 4 bursts per second were generated in these high-level frontal areas, and that each gamma burst, that the burst had about a mean bandwidth of about 44 hertz. And again, the center frequency at which the bursts happened were highly variable, and that's potentially why when you average across many trials, you see only a very broadband kind of gamma. If you zoom in to potentially individual trials, you might see something that's much more narrowband. So first, what happens with the burst rate as we engage as the animals engage in this task? So the beta burst rate decreases during stimulus presentation and delay. So here we have the cue onset, beta burst decreases, they recover a little bit prior to the mask onset. When that comes down, again, you have a decrease in the beta burst rate, and then that decreases slightly during the delay period. And this is sort of similar between superficial and deep layers. In the gamma burst rate, we have a slightly different story. So here, we have gamma bursts happening in both superficial and deep layers, but interestingly, which increase in the mask and to the delay, but interestingly, the deep layers actually show a higher burst rate than the superficial layers, which is a little bit counterintuitive given the fact that just the raw power seemed to be higher in the superficial layers. Nevertheless, we see that the bursting is quite robust in the deep layers. What about information? Are these bursts actually carrying information about the item that's being held in working memory? So here what we see is that in the beta band, again, there is some information, but very little. And it's not very task modulated, so it just kind of stays the same across the queue and mask. Some dynamics, but it's pretty close to zero. This is unbiased information. So you do expect zero if there is no information. There's some, but it's pretty small. Gamma is carrying much more information. And here we see something interesting again. The superficial layers carry actually the most information about the item held in working memory compared to the deep layers, which, although they are bursting, they don't carry much information, and they're not task modulated at all in the sense that they just sort of stay flat throughout the whole task period that we're analyzing here. And so also you might wonder, why is information positive here before the queue? The reason for that is that we alternated between blocks where the queue was repeated over trials and other blocks where it was sort of randomized. And so because of that experimental trial design, we do have some information prior to the queue, which was hanging on from the last trial. But nevertheless, what we find here is that the superficial gamma in bursts and the particular time occurrence of these bursts seems to carry information about working memory, but not so much beta and not so much the deep layers. It seems to be a phenomenon more specific to the superficial layer gamma bursting. What about the spikes? So we were doing intracranial recordings here in monkeys, so we can also image the spiking responses. And so here what we see is something, again, that maps on pretty neatly to what we saw in the gamma bursting, which is that you see an enhanced response here in the delay, which is quite pronounced and pretty specific to the superficial layers compared to the deep layers. So the deep layers, they show a little bit of a sensory response, especially to the mask, exceeding the baseline quite a bit. But then during the delay, they don't really do much. In fact, they almost come back down to baseline. So there's just a hint of delay period activity in the deep layers. It's really the superficial layers that are carrying it away and that are increasing their activity during the delay. And now imaging this, not only in this more gross superficial versus deep distinction, but according to distance away from the where we think is the middle, corresponding to that current source density sink, we can even get a stronger glimpse at how segregated this activity is towards the superficial layers. So it's quite a strong effect that it seems like the delay period activity is selective there. Next, we did a few other analyses inspired by previous work on laminar functional physiology. Namely, previous work has found that there's a selected phase amplitude coupling. And so particularly the work by Elke Spock and Ole Jensen has shown that the deep layers in V1, the alpha, and the deep layers, the phase modulates superficial gamma amplitude. And so we're wondering, what does it do in frontal cortex? And what we found was something that's highly coherent with the previous work in V1, namely that the deep alpha phase modulates the more superficial gamma amplitude. So that's how you read these plots here. And cross-frequency coupling here was quantified using the modulation index. And so these are significant values which are segregated to this particular part of the matrix. Also, you have some local superficial alpha phase modulating superficial gamma amplitude. But for us, the interesting bit is this off-diagonal term here, which again maps onto visual cortex. So again, a little bit more evidence here that different cortical areas might be expressing similar functional anatomies. And I'll get to my interpretation of what I think is happening here in a second. In addition to that, we did just simple coherence analysis, taking bipolar derivations in the superficial and deep layers and seeing, are they synchronized? Indeed, they were. And deep and superficial layers had two peaks in the alpha and beta band. Directed functional connectivity then revealed that this coherence had a directionality, namely that the deep alpha is driving the superficial alpha in red here. This is Granger causality analysis with the peaks at about where you would expect given the coherence. In the reverse direction, superficial to deep, we don't see much influence there at these frequencies, and it's pretty close to zero. So this interaction here is dominated by an ascending connectivity. One other observation that I'd like to make before getting to sort of how I think this fits together is that we were also showing the animal just in a passive viewing condition to get the current sinks and sources. We were also just blasting the screen, making it go from black to white, and just generating as much excitation as we could to see, you know, are there any sensory responses in these higher level areas? And what we found is that there indeed there is. As you can see here in the laminar plot, pretty much all the layers respond to the initial sensory information that comes in, the sensory stimulus that comes in. It's a very bright stimulus. But interestingly, the superficial layers, they seem to hold on to this response, even though it's not behaviorally relevant at all. In other words, it's almost like these superficial layers are primed to express some kind of delay period activity to whatever is coming in from the environment, and that they need some kind of inhibitory mechanism to bring this so-called delay period activity, or at least sustained activity, down back to baseline. The other observation that was somewhat interesting is that this sort of decay back down to baseline seems to have a rhythmicity of its own following approximately the alpha band. And this hyperexcitability or delay-like activity is really, again, something that we see only in superficial and not the deep layers. So I'd like to just propose a toy model here that puts these things together, and then we can talk about whether or not this is something that fits in predictive coding, and if so, how. So I have some basically here just two compartments for now: the superficial compartment and the deep compartment, which both obviously have excitatory and inhibitory cells. They have recurrent interactions. Of course, recurrent interactions is what gives us oscillations to begin with. And so multiple modeling work, some experimental work with pharmacology, and some neural field work by my colleague Dimitris here, suggests that the reason you get these spectral asymmetries between superficial and deep cells is that you have faster synaptic time constants on average in superficial layers and slower synaptic time constants on average in the deep layers, generating this slower activity, i.e. faster gamma dynamics superficial and slower alpha dynamics or beta dynamics, depending on the area, in the deep layers. So experimentally, we've seen this in multiple works, including in the present work, is that these ongoing dynamics or this functional architecture that seems to be present, and we've seen this now in multiple areas, creates this spectral asymmetry where you have the gamma, representing gamma here with this blue squiggle superficially, and the alpha deep. And now if you think about it, this already gives us somewhat of a, I think, important insight as to what different layers are doing. If we think about it, what has been associated most strongly with the presence of alpha? Well, it's inhibition. Active inhibition is the story, and I think there's a lot of evidence for that, including evidence showing that spikes are directly inhibited by the alpha rhythm. In addition, what has been mostly tied with gamma oscillations? Well, it's the presence of fast synchronous gain, it's the presence of this rich information encoding, it's this presence of rich bottom-up dynamics that are stimulus encoding and that carry information, right? So already from this single observation, we might say that maybe, you know, there are some information processing circuits happening in the superficial layers, and potentially less of that, or something more related to inhibition or more related to gain modulation in some ways happening down here. So we also know that there's ascending and indeed probably descending connections between the superficial and the deep layers. And so what this causes is coherence that we observed in this work, coherence between the two layers, and also an ascending drive in the alpha, so ascending from deep to superficial layers. And again, this is work that has been shown here and also reported previously in other parts of the brain, namely in visual cortex. And so what I think is happening is that this rhythmic inhibitory ascending alpha drive is potentially what's creating the cross-frequency coupling, i.e. the bouts of inhibition that that make your gamma amplitudes and gamma bursts go down, and others where they come up again and are able to express gamma. In addition to that, we also, of course, have spikes, and the present work here shows that superficial layer spikes, but not so much the other spikes, engage in the sustained delay period activity. And this is true both in the task context, where working memory actually has to be used to direct behavior and direct a saccade, as well as in the passive visual stimulation case, where we have delay-like or sustained activity in the absence of any overt behavior that needs to accompany that. And so the proposal here is that what the alpha oscillations and the interlaminar connectivity might be doing is it might be gating which incoming sensory areas, incoming sensory inputs, are routed to the superficial layer network, which then has the necessary dynamics and necessary dynamics to sustain activity and hold it in working memory. So what I'm depicting here is in the case where we might want to shut down the superficial layer compartment. Maybe alpha would increase to then decrease the gamma bursting rate and decreasing the spikes and decreasing the information in those spikes and cancel those items from working memory. So the conclusion here is that it seems like gamma and alpha oscillations, as previously reported, are very asymmetric in the layers in which they're expressed. Namely, gamma is strong in superficial and alpha is strong in the deep layers. The delay period power in gamma is stronger, the burst rate is stronger. Delay period information is stronger in gamma and is stronger in the superficial layers and carries, and superficial layer gamma bursts carry the most information about working memory. The delay period activity also matches that, is almost exclusively present in superficial layers. And spiking responses to just passive visual stimulation cause delay-like sustained activity in the superficial layers, which have a 10 hertz periodicity in their decay back down to baseline. And this is absent in deep layers. And then the deep layers we see here modulate the superficial layers via frequency-specific directed interactions. Namely, deep layer alpha phase modulates superficial gamma amplitude, and the deep layers drive the superficial layers in this alpha-beta range. And I think this conceptual model points to how we could put all these things together for potentially a circuit that could implement working memory type computations. And that, of course, is going to require some more research to flesh that out. But that's the initial view that I come to from the current analysis. And lastly, to tie this into predictive coding, we see that working memory, it seems to recruit superficial layer fast gamma circuits. And these gamma circuits have been implicated in perception and prediction error computations in previous work. So how is it now that a purely cognitively top-down process is engaging these dynamics, which we think are involved in bottom-up connectivity? And that's going to bring me to just a short discussion section, which I hope can maybe lead to some questions and more things that we can talk about here. So again, previous work suggests that the superficial gamma activity in visual cortex feeds forward up the hierarchy, correct? Here, we find it to be involved in working memory maintenance, which is a prototypical top-down cognitive function. The canonical microcircuit model predicts there is an anatomical or computational circuit that's conserved across the cortex, right? And that sort of begs the question, what is the feed forward, or what is the superficial layer or the feed forward layer doing when it's at the top of the hierarchy? Here, we do actually find some evidence for conserved functional anatomy in frontal circuits. That conserved meaning it looks similar to previous work in visual cortex. Namely, we see this alpha-gamma asymmetry, this cross-frequency coupling, the upward alpha flow, the pattern of current sinks that I didn't show you. All of these things seem to match with previously known results from visual cortex. So this is some evidence for conserved functional anatomy. And again, in frontal cortex, there is no more feed forward. So these superficial cells, they might be co-opted for a new role when they're at the top of the hierarchy. There's no more feed forward for them to feed forward into, but they're still there, i.e. there's a conserved canonical circuit. So it's not like the brain is going to just remove those layer 2-3 cells just because we're at the top of the hierarchy and make it only a layer 5-6 column, right? And so their new role may be to maintain information in working memory via the same or perhaps similar mechanisms to how signals are fed forward and in a prediction error coding sense in sensory hierarchies. And so these information-rich gamma bursts and robust spiking responses are carrying the information and sustaining activity during the delay period in a task and in a context in which we might not necessarily expect these fast dynamics to be at play. And again, this relates back to the question of, you know, how do you get things like working memory or imagination from predictive coding, in the sense that you might have hierarchies that are built on top of each other and that are no longer trying to predict only sense data, but trying to predict, trying to make new predictions that are longer out in time and that may not be constrained by the immediate sensory environment. So that's the general model, and I'd like to discuss it or other things if you'd like. And just to acknowledge the guys who helped me with this, so Roman Lunas is a PhD student in the lab who I collaborated with on this project. Michael is the one that came up with the gamma bursting idea based on his modeling work from his PhD, and I highly recommend that you guys check out his neuron paper, which is just out a couple months ago if you're interested in working memory. And finally to Earl Miller and the whole Miller lab, and thank you for your attention.
Well, thanks a lot. Questions? Do we have?
What happens after the end of the plot? So we have increase of gamma activity. Mm-hmm. Does it go down when animal responds and gets the juice? Does it maintain the state, kind of flowing into the next trial?
I'm not sure.
I'm sorry. Okay, thanks. Yeah.
But you're right. That would maybe inform this idea here of whether the when you no longer need this working memory information, does it then come back down to baseline? And does it come back down to baseline potentially in an alpha inhibitory regime? So that would be the expectation that I would carry into the next investigation of this data set. But thanks for your question.
So as far as I understood, the superficial layers respond to a visual stimulus. They sustain their response to some degree, and then during working memory, they encode the item that's of interest. Mm-hmm. So that all sounded to me consistent, you know, the long time scale of the response, the fact that they carry the important information for the task, consistent with more like a state type representation, not necessarily a prediction error. So, and it's, yeah, so that's how I interpret it, but maybe you can convince me otherwise.
No, I think that's perfectly good interpretation. The only thing I was mentioning is that in previous work, we've associated those superficial layers and the gamma frequencies with prediction error responses. And so I think we're going to need to get better at really understanding what is the functional architecture of the predictive coding circuits. And so this is somewhat of a just initial view. And that's just the question. Is it a prediction error, or is it a state encoding? And indeed, since it's sustained, it looks more like a state-type response. The only thing that would contradict that is if this notion is really true, that in sensory hierarchies, and indeed throughout the cortex, you have prediction error units that are somewhat segregated to superficial layers. And again, here in the conference, we've seen some evidence that they are and some evidence that they're not.
Right, and to be fair, you could have both in the superficial layers, and your task may have activated, you know, these working memory state-like representations, and then had you changed it up, you would have gotten errors in the superficial layers. So I'm not doubting that you could have both. I was just wondering how you interpreted the current signal. But then the other, just to follow up, what is the link between gamma and prediction error that you're referring to that shows
so,
up?
So I would link actually Lucia's work to this, which was investigating hypotheses that have been put forward by the field.
Did you encode the context, the content of the information that you have about the task? So, and how do you do this? I mean, is this like encoded in the frequency or in the are there oscillations that encode for the one direction and the other direction? Those are encoding Sakai directions, right? That's the
basically, I mean, the animal was 90% correct, which meant that on 90% of the trials, the working memory information was also the same as the saccade information. But yeah, these areas are not just sort of activated by saccades per se. They're also interested in sort of more protracted responses that are not directly tied to the onset of the saccade.
I mean, this is something Carl mentioned over lunch again. These oscillations also remind us to the potential of encoding memory content by what Wolfgang Maas has proposed, liquid machineries. So in a way, you have an oscillatory pattern that can be read out at many different places, and the metaphor is, you know, you throw stones into a pond and that gives ripples on the surface, and you can read out the surface ripples from any place, and it contains the information about where the stones have been thrown in and how heavy they are and so on. And so I mean, I don't know all the details of that, but oscillatory patterns could be very potent in having this kind of memory trace, and could be read out actually from various areas. And so maybe you know, these high frequency oscillatory patterns are very potent in being this reservoir of memory.
Absolutely, yeah. That's indeed what we find here, is that the temporal occurrence of bursts in a given potential trial is carrying information about which of the six possible locations. So that's how we did the analysis, is whether or not the occurrence of a burst on this particular electrode in this trial, you know, is consistent with a particular location. So that could mean that certain locations are encoded by a higher or lower burst rate, basically. So it's the burst rate at particular moments in time that are those ripples of information encoding entities that we find. Yeah, so I absolutely subscribe to that notion. Yeah, how they're being communicated to the other areas is another important question that I haven't addressed here. And so are these gamma bursts, are they then coordinated between areas? We just don't, we don't know. You know, we know that in visual cortex, when you represent a stimulus, the gamma bursts or continuous gamma oscillations, they are coordinated across areas. Whether the same is the case in this paradigm, which involves a different kind of gamma, we're not sure yet. But I'm going to be able to address this very soon, because in my current recording setup and recording data, I am actually recording multiple sites with the multilaminar probe. So I'm recording in visual cortex as well as prefrontal and parietal. So hopefully that'll give us a better sense of whether there's coordination across these superficial lamina, or potentially where the deep layers are actually involved in more, you know, global network-like activity. Yes, please.
I have a question that's it's maybe sort of a basic circuitry question. I'm not sure it ties into your prefrontal working memory stuff, but you know, in your schematic towards the beginning, you have thalamic input and then these sort of like, you know, hierarchical cortical layer or cortical areas. And that makes sense for like LGN, but I'm wondering about things like pulvinar, where you have sort of thalamocortical circuits, you know, reiterated at a variety of stages. I just wonder how that might fit into the, what role those might play in predictive coding, if any at all.
I think Carl had a nice slide on that in his talk, where in his discrete predictive coding model, you have this descending connections to a subcortical source, which then projects back up. In the predictive coding that that we've proposed, it basically is a cortical-cortical type model, so where you have the LGN indeed feeding into the first layer, and then the first layer feeds into the next layer the same way that it received LGN input, and you have sort of a chain of inputs. How the pulvinar fits into that story is not currently clear. So it's something that I think should be explored, but the classical models don't address.
I was wondering, I'm not quite sure what happens in the monkey, but usually in the human tasks, it's dorsolateral prefrontal cortex that is active during working memory tasks. So is there something special about that area? You were talking about just frontal cortex in general, and it seems like there's a lot of territory there. So what gives the, you know, working memory part of cortex special?
It was not a principled sort of selection. It was based on the data that we could acquire relatively easily and quickly, where animals were already implanted. So again, there has been this delay period activity reported in other areas apart from dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. So for the moment, at least, we weren't too concerned that we weren't in those canonical areas. And so we still have, I think, a lot of construct validity to those results, because we do know that that delay activity is protracted over a wide frontal network. That being said, again, in more current recordings, which I haven't had a chance to fully analyze yet, we are doing and repeating this in dorsolateral and ventrolateral prefrontal cortex. My expectation is that we're going to see similar things, but yeah, I'll be able to report on that quite soon.
Just my neuroimaging biased, ignorant question. In those spectral plots, you went up to like 150, 200 hertz, right? So later you would get into spiking regime, right? Yeah. Is there a relation between, let's say, those gamma bursts and spikes? Let's say when you talk to people who deal with mean spike rate, right? So they encode like representation is in spikes. Here we have working memory model, which works in terms of frequencies. Is there any some
unification? Well, there are spikes. There are spikes also in the data. Definitely.
Right, but did you look and either they anyhow related in these, let's say, maintaining the memory?
Yeah, I haven't looked at how they are related yet. But previous meaning, like just published now work, shows that you actually have a higher spike rate inside of the gamma burst than outside of the gamma burst. Mm-hmm. And again, the gamma burst itself, we don't think it is an, you know, trivially caused by artifactual spike bleeding, because it is more protracted in time, given what you would expect by the occurrence of just a spike itself. Mm-hmm. It is a little bit tricky to separate that in the data, but what my colleague did and what I still have to do is to look at controlling electrode sites by their spike rate and then looking at changes in information according to which ones have gamma bursts or not. And so that has been established already in that other data set, and I think pretty convincingly rules out that it's not whether or not you have spikes that kind of coincides with information, mm-hmm. it's whether or not you have the gamma bursts that is the critical factor for expressing information or not. And the idea is that you have sort of a retractor-like state where you're revisiting the particular location in the network, which holds the item into working memory. And every time the network revisits that state, it coincides with a high burst of inhibitory-excitatory interactions leading to the gamma burst and to spiking activity, which represents the stimulus. And then as you go away, those sites go back down to being quiet, and what holds information in the intervening time is the synaptic weights between those units that have been active. So that's a little bit more about the kind of computational model that inspired Michael's analysis. And he's now done analysis in several other data sets. I've now done analysis in several other data sets that I've collected. And we see these gamma bursts coming up in frontal circuits everywhere that we look so far. So it was really sort of a failure in our field and for us, of course, also, in the sense that we didn't do this, you know, more sensitive single trial analysis, zooming in to find out, you know, these rich spatial temporal dynamics that are present and highly informative, but that you have to do a single trial analysis for. Mm-hmm. And so another thing that I think this work points out to is the notion for understanding the brain at a trial-by-trial level, because our cognition happens on a moment-by-moment level. So we need to maybe fine-tune our analyses and the types of data to collect that we collect to maybe disclose that more.
Mm-hmm. So do you think, like, going back to yesterday's De Carolus talk, mm-hmm. right, if we are trying to compare artificial neural network to real neural network, if he was dealing not with mean spike rates, but let's say gamma burst power,
yeah.
would there be a relationship? Would it be better relationship?
I think there would be a relationship, and I think those guys should definitely look into it, although I think it's prohibited by the boss right now. I don't know.
Thank you.
Or there's not enough interest in that field yet about that, but, you know, who knows? Hopefully if we, you know, enhance our ability to really know what's going on in the functional architecture and, you know, tie a very important role for these oscillations and things like working memory and things like, you know, prediction error responses, then, you know, we can have more evidence for that in, you know, purely feed-forward, bottom-up type data analysis as well.
Could you just elaborate a little bit more about how you see information representation in the working memory through the whole circuit? You know, through the whole predictive coding circuit.
Sure.
Because my understanding is that, you know, the information doesn't reside exclusively in prefrontal cortex. There's also sustained activity in IT cortex for objects. There's even sustained activity in V1 cortex.
Well, that's actually like not true in the canonical sense of spike rate, right?
Yeah,
so
but
you know, you actually don't find spikes in. So let me turn real quick to
But you can decode things like the orientation of gratings held in working
yes,
memory.
Yes, yes, I know that. I know that. But we have to be careful here because decoding is not the same as coming up with a very clear mechanistic understanding of what's happening, right?
Yeah, so that's my question.
And so what my colleague at MIT, he did his PhD with Trujillo in Canada. And he's now with Bob Desimone. So he published this really nice paper here. And I'm taking a figure from it that is not going to make the point. I'm just going to make it verbally. But I'll point you to this paper, is that he started with exactly this view. Why is it that in fMRI, you can decode things from V1, V2, V4, but we don't really see, we see in physiology that those locations are highly bottom-up driven. There's no, you know, there's very little spiking actually happening during the delay period or during, you know, states where the stimulus isn't present. And so what he showed is that when he looked at, in his task, MT and MST, in MT, you don't have any delay period activity, zero, boom, just stimulus comes up. When it goes down, those spikes go back to baseline. At the next hierarchical level, MST, you do get delay period activity. You get sustained responses there. And so you see a sharp emergence of delay period activity, of this rich information processing dynamics during the delay period, likely, in my mind at least, tied to gamma band bursting in the superficial layers, although that remains to be seen. What he also saw is that prefrontal cortex, and this is the slide here, prefrontal cortex spikes feeding into LFPs in those areas that did not show sustained activity did encode, actually, the working memory representation, but in a different way, not via spikes, but via field spike-to-field coupling. So spikes in PFC leading to changes in sub-threshold activity in the alpha and beta range, which is what's being highlighted in subpanel A here, the number of spike field units that contained information about working memory. And so this is potentially the mechanism of what's happening here, is that you have sub-threshold activity visible in fMRI, not visible in spikes, visible in spike field interactions, which are potentially preparing the circuit for incoming processing when you do have bottom-up
representation. So what's your speculation on how information-specific that preparation is? I mean, because, you know, the suggestion is that the signal in V1 is very information rich.
Right.
And if it's all in this LFP modulatory context, how do you see that working?
Well, I mean, even Lars showed that it's rich, but it's not as rich as the bottom-up stimulus, right? So the bottom-up stimulus can classify with maybe, 90% accuracy, 80, 90%? And the top-down, purely imagination-based information in V1 can quantify between I think it was 55 to maybe at the best subject is 70 or so percent. So you do have some loss of information entailed with not representing things in, through this rich spiking dynamics that we see with bottom-up stimulation. That being said, I mean, that, you know, that's not chance level. So those dynamics are very rich
information
and very
there,
meaningful.
I thought the hypothesis is that there's enough information so that you can calculate prediction error from that, right? So you have a prediction in V1, so you can compare the input to the prediction error and
So my point
and calculate
is that,
prediction error for what will be fed forward.
Right. My point is that that's sort of classically how we view the prediction error machinery, is that you have these high-level prediction. So this would actually fit with that, right? So you have high-level predictions in prefrontal cortex. They generate descending connections through their deep layers. They feed back down the hierarchy all the way, in this case, to MST. In other work, like my work, the beta band is also communicating down into V4, V2, and V1. That activity then sets up networks that indeed are, in this work, representing working memory contents. In my work with Pascal and my PhD, we showed that those descending beta band connectivity was also influencing attention, so acting on the network in a top-down sense, and then preparing the network for the incoming sensory inputs, resulting in things like what Lucia showed, which is a decrease in the superficial gamma dynamics when things are expected relative to unexpected, i.e. exactly the cortical architecture and exactly the functional dynamics that we expect to be present in a predictive coding scheme which has a hierarchical nature to it, right? So I think the evidence is getting somewhat compelling for that notion. What I sort of put forward in the talk is that, well, I think maybe there is some evidence for that as you look at prediction error computations in sensory cortical areas, but what about when you get to the very top of the hierarchy? Well, it's not really clear what the prediction error means at the top of the hierarchy. And then there's this notion that maybe you have many hierarchies on top of each other which get further and further away from the sensory data and which are more about what's being held in working memory as the basis, as the sort of core architecture that could be the basis for things like imagination, or holding things in mind that aren't really there. And indeed, that might actually surf all the way back to V1. That's a core prediction that you have, that when you do make a prediction, that prediction is going to have consequences for the entire network. So you're going to get descending activity. Although where in the hierarchy that prediction is made or that prediction error is made, I think is going to go further up, the more cognitive and the less tied to the immediate sensory environment that is. Although this is very speculative here, because classical predictive coding is, you know, beep, 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 boop, or beep, 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 boop, beep, 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 boop, beep, 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 nothing, right, the omission response. So most of the evidence there over the last 5 years or so is in sensory hierarchies.
Thanks, Andre. Very nice talk. My question is a little bit probably unrelated to your findings itself, but it just struck me that so Xiaojing Wan has shown this idea of different time scales, for different areas, right? And I as showing the different time counts of the predictions that each area would have. Yeah. And now you're showing us that at the top of the hierarchy we have the same alpha oscillations as we would have found in B1, A1. So it's kind of like it just cannot wrap my head around these two different findings, right? Yeah. Because I would have expected slower time dynamics in prefrontal, but it doesn't seem to be the case. So do you have any idea why?
Well, it could be that it is the case, but that you still have some preservation of those higher frequencies. So the spectrum might shift down. We still have to look at this. I don't think there's any evidence to contradict this view. Indeed, Xiaojing Wang does show that at the level of neural spikes and their autocorrelations, that those autocorrelations, i.e. their ability to spike at fast timescales, independent of in each spike remaining independent of one another, that timescale increases massively. And that could be exactly what's happening here. That's the reason that potentially, and Xiaojing Wang has also modeled this as a model for working memory, actually, that as you go up the hierarchy, you have these longer timescales, so you can do things like maintain things in working memory. And that could be what is explaining this effect here, that even in a purely bottom-up stimulation of these high-level frontal areas, you see delay period activity. Because they have these longer time constants by nature, they're sort of kicked in to information representation states even when it's not potentially critical. So you need mechanisms to inhibit that and bring it back down to baseline.
I agree, but what struck me was that it was still alpha, which, that's the weird part, right? Because, you would expect that here it would have been theta or something else, delta, something, it's lower pace, right? But it's not.
Yeah, it's not. Again, there could be a slight shift also in the power spectrum towards slower frequencies. We'll certainly look into that and see if you see this. But I would also point out that the canonical microcircuit hypothesis would also say that you should have preserved alpha and gamma dynamics across different areas, because you do expect that there's some conserved functional anatomy, which then each area changes in its own particular way and need according to inputs and outputs and according to the computations it needs to perform. But at the end of the day, there's going to be some preservation of dynamics and computations across different areas. And that could be what's happening here. And that's not contradictory to this notion that you might also have slower timescales. Yeah. So you have some differences and many similarities is sort of I think how I look at the notion of canonical microcircuits.
Okay.